Hear now the reading of the Word of God. First, a commendation from Christ. John 15, verses 16 and 17. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear much fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. This is my commandment, that you love one another. And then from the 10th chapter of Matthew, verses 32 and 33, therefore, whoever confesses me before men, him will I confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, him will I deny before my Father who is in heaven. And from Matthew 4, the 19th verse, I will make you fishers of men. And from the 15th verse of the 21st chapter of Luke, I will give you a mouth and wisdom that your adversaries will not be able to contradict or resist. Hear the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious, living Lord, help us to understand the wondrous confidence that you have placed in us, and help us to live now so richly and fully that at the end of life we need fear our death no more than falling asleep and rising to a new day. In your holy name, amen. This message was conceived 7 months ago. The specific preparation for it took place during this past week. But a few hours ago, I had a life and death experience that drew what I want to say into sharp focus. Yesterday morning, I held in my arms a beloved family of this congregation, the Peter Dick family. As they sobbed out their grief over the death of their 17-year-old boy, he was involved in a tragic automobile accident, killed on impact, his handsome body charred in the flames. During my time with the family, I was profoundly moved by the faith that they had in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and their firm conviction that Chris Dick is alive. I couldn't help but think, how do people face the tragedies and losses and difficulties of life without Christ? But as I drove away, I had a mingled sense of pathos and praise. Pathos for this wonderful family and for their grief, but praise that Chris Dick knew Jesus Christ, that he had become a faithful disciple, that he was a witness to his friends, and that he was alive. And then I got back to my study, and I looked at the manuscript I had prepared for this moment. And the topic sentence was as follows. Every so often in our lives, we need to take an inventory of our eternal life to see if all that we believe and do and say adds up to an assurance of the abundant life now and eternal life forever. I sat stunned. I had just been through an experience that had been a reassurance that everything Jesus Christ has promised is true. Amen. And that death is not an ending, but a transition for those who believe in Him, are His disciples, and are His witnesses. That's awesome to me. I want you to take that kind of an inventory. Whether you're 17 or 70, are you sure? If this were your day, where would you spend eternity? Three wonderful things can give us that assurance. First of all, Christ's astounding call of us. Secondly, Christ's amazing confidence in us. And thirdly, Christ's alarming condition about us. We can't consider the third until we reviewed the first two. But having reviewed the first two, we must face the third. Think of it. The awesome choice of Christ. It is our election. It is our predestined assurance. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear much fruit and that your fruit should remain. And then, whatever you ask the Father in my name, He will give it to you. This is my commandment, that you love one another. It is an astounding thing, isn't it? It startles the mind, stirs the soul. But before we chose Christ, He chose us. Before we even desired to know Him, He desired us. A wondrous, affirming, encouraging fact that He wants us, He wants to be with us, He likes us as well as loves us. And as He passes through, He looks at you and says, now there's a man, there's a woman. I'd like to be with him or her. They're the very stuff out of which I can make an eternal person. It's so customary of Christ. All through His ministry, He called the most unlikely people, like you and me. You see, He had quadrifocal lens in His soul. He could see not only what people had been, but what they were, what they could become as persons, and what they could do as a part of the enterprise of the kingdom. It says that Jesus looked at Simon Peter. And then He said to him, Simon, son of Jonah, you shall be Cephas. Later in the 16th chapter of Matthew, He said, you are Peter, and upon this rock, the rock of your faith, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And now, it is you, a little scrawny man. Couldn't see around people or leap up high enough to see over them, but he knew that Jesus was coming to Jericho, and he wanted to see him without Jesus seeing him. He wanted to make a choice about Jesus without Jesus making a choice about him. And so he scurried up into a tree so that he could observe Jesus. And Jesus made his way down the road, and then suddenly he was underneath the tree. Zacchaeus, come down. I want to dwell in your house today. Why me? Why of all the people in Jericho do you want me? Nobody likes me here. I'm a hated tax collector. And if you knew my background, Jesus, you wouldn't be asking me to come down out of this tree. Zacchaeus, come down. And so he came down, and in his hours with Jesus, his life was transformed. It's even said that he became a bishop in the early church. And now, it is you. A woman of the streets, hated and abhorred, soiled. And yet Jesus said, neither do I condemn you, go in peace. And now it is you. Salome. Constantly scrapping with other people to get her sons ahead. Indeed, an ambitious mother. And yet Jesus chose her to be one of the essential group of disciples and followers to whom the Spirit would be given. She witnessed the crucifixion and the resurrection. She was there at Pentecost. And now it is you. A scholar from the Sanhedrin, Nicodemus, had to slip through the night because he didn't want anyone else to see him. What's all this about, Master? And Jesus told him about the new birth. And we know from subsequent history that he experienced that with the resurrected Lord. And now it is you. What a record. Jesus chose unlikely people to get his job done. You have not chosen me. I've chosen you. Let me reword a wonderful verse. A poet wrote it about his beloved. I will not let you go. I hold you by too many bands. You say farewell, and lo, I have you by the hands. I cannot let you go. That's what Christ says to you right now. He's got a hold of your hands and your heart, your mind, and he won't let go. And so we reword another verse. Let me no more my comfort draw from my frail grasp on thee. In this alone rejoice with awe, your mighty choice of me. But not only that, move on. Christ's amazing confidence in us, the likes of us. Can you imagine that he'd stake his whole plan and strategy on using people like you and me, and yet he has. Oh, it's an apocryphal story, and it's told often, spun out by amazed minds, that when Jesus went back to heaven after the crucifixion, that the archangel met him and said, did you do the deed? Did you finish the work that you were to do? Oh, yes. I preached the kingdom. I reconciled people to God through my death. I was raised from the dead. Well, that's wonderful, said the archangel. Did you leave your work in competent hands? Are there tens and tens of thousands of them? Oh, they're fit all right, said Jesus. But there are only 130 of them, and Archangel, I've got to explain that there's a few fishermen, an insurrectionist or two, a tax collector, some women off the street, some competitive women, a man from the Sanhedrin that never wanted to be known, and I've also got my eye on another member of the Sanhedrin. He's from Tarsus. His name is Saul, and I think we can change the world through his mind and writing. You don't have any other plan? No? I have no other plan. And And out of 130 filled with the Spirit, Jesus Christ moved across the then known world. And down through the centuries, he has changed people who knew that they were called and were filled with him. And now, it is you. But move on. Not only that, consider also Christ's alarming condition about us. We couldn't consider it until now. Without the first 2 points, we couldn't take it. It would rattle our cage, disturb us so we couldn't hear it. But listen to the Savior. Therefore, everyone who confesses me before men, I will confess before the Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father who is in heaven. Now, if that doesn't shake you to your foundations, I don't know what will. It isn't just faith in Christ that gets us into heaven. It's being his witness. It means confessing him before people, using our influence to share his power and his love, caring about people until we have the opportunity to explain to them what Christ means to us. It's taking a stand in the conflict and difficult issues of our time, regardless of what it costs us, putting him first, letting the whole world know that everything we have and are is his gift. And if not, Christ doesn't change his terms. Oh, we swagger about and say, I have the gift of faith. I believe for years. And Jesus says, are you my faithful confessing witness? Is anyone in heaven because of you? Is anyone going to heaven because you loved and cared and introduced them to me? What evidence is there that you're involved in the crises of our society right now, giving yourself, caring, giving your money, pouring yourself out? If you consistently deny me, if you remain as a closet Christian, clandestine, refusing to be open and honest about the fact that you belong to him, what then? What then? He said he would deny us before the Father. Why? Well, if we didn't want anyone else to know what we believed, and if we constantly hedged our witness, and if we were silent in crises, and evil passed around us and we did nothing about it, then I wonder, if we didn't want heaven on earth under his rule, will we want it in heaven in eternity? You see, that's why yesterday morning meant so much to me. That 17-year-old boy had a cross around his neck, and the cross in his heart, and the resurrection in his heart. And when he died in that moment, he was alive. Where are you going to spend eternity? And what difference does it make now? Whoso has felt the Spirit of the Highest cannot confound or doubt him or deny. Yea, O world, though thou deniest, stand on that side, for on his side stand I. What say you?